life is art. Art is life. This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis, coming to you from New York.
Thanks for joining us today on Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we are thrilled to have American tenor Paul Groves with us. Paul has, for the last more than 20 years, enjoyed an international career singing major roles in major opera houses around the world. Welcome, Paul.
I'm very glad to be here.
Good to have you.
Thank you.
I'm thinking back to 1991 when you were a member of an incredible year of National Council at the Met program finalists. Can you believe that that was, 14 years ago? 24 years ago.
Yeah, 24 years.
How quickly time goes by. But wasn't that quite a year for singers?
Yes, it was. And then I joined the Met Young Artist program, and, you know, we had so many of us are still singing and still very successful. And even the ones that were a few years before me, like Dwayne Croft and Heidi Grant Murphy, and we're all still going. And it says a lot about who was in charge of the Young Artist program at that time. You know, James Devine had quite a bit of influence, and also Gail Robinson was in charge of it. And being a singer herself and having quite a Met career a generation before I did, she really knew who not only had the talent, the vocal talent, but who had the staying power and who had a chance to have a long career at the Met. So she had extremely successful years when she was in charge of the program.
What was the most important thing you learned in those years in the Young Artist program?
Well, the most important thing I learned was from Gail, and I guess really from James Devine, was that I should start my career on the very lyric side for the tenor voice, which I was at Juilliard before I came to the Met, and then I went to school in Louisiana State at Louisiana State University, and I just assumed that I was going to be the next Placido Domingo. Mm-hmm. So even though you hear these people on stage, you have no idea what their voice actually is until you stand next to them and hear what is produced. So sometime in my first couple of months, James Devine called me in for coaching, and I sang Mozart roles. But I also sang other stuff that was, you know, I thought, well, maybe I can do this. But in fact, 20 years down the road, I can do those operas. But I didn't know that. You know, I was young and, you know, completely immature for, you
know. Or innocent.
Yeah. I wouldn't say innocent. But so James Devine said, you know, you sing these Mozart operas better than I've heard in years, and you have the voice for this, and also you can, by your passion that you have for the music, you can bring something to the stage in these roles that you don't usually see in Mozart operas. And I figured he probably knew what he was talking about. and so I really, in those years, I really concentrated on Mozart. And I was led by, you know, James Devine and Gail and Jonathan Friend. And they let me cover all the Mozart roles in those 3 years. And then I got to sing a few things. And that really started my career. And it was such a brilliant idea. And I'd probably be done if I didn't take their advice. I wouldn't be singing at 50 years old for sure.
Let's go back a little bit. How did you get to that point? When you were young and you already know that you want to be a singer?
Well, I knew I wanted to do something in music because my father was a conductor and he was head of the music department at State University in Louisiana. Mm. And my mom was a singer and almost everyone in my family. Now, not necessarily classical trained, but my grandfather had a radio show on the Louisiana Hayride, which was from Shreveport, Louisiana. Back, he and his brothers had a quartet in the 40s. And then I have uncles that played the violin. And, you know, so, you know, there was always music in my family. So I knew I wanted to do something in music. But I was lucky enough to go to Louisiana State University the same year that Martina Arroyo and Robert Grayson, who was a leading tenor at the New York City Opera, came to teach. And they took me aside in my first year there, and they said, you know, because I actually auditioned for the chorus. I was auditioning for Così fan tutte for the chorus. Mm-hmm. And I went in and sang, you know, the first aria, Ferrando's first aria, and they took me aside and said, you know, I I do believe you could have an operatic career, you know. So I took their advice also. I was always very good at, you know, following advice from people that I knew certainly had a good idea about what I should be doing.
So in other words, when you were in high school or junior high, you already know, you have the feeling for it.
Well, I knew I would do something in music. My father bought me, we went to the Houston Opera every once in a while because I grew up in Lake Charles, Louisiana. It's only 2 hours away. Mm-hmm. And we went to, you know, my dad liked the opera, so every once in a while we'd go see something important there. You know, we saw the opening of the Aida, which was opening. We also saw Bernstein's, because my father loved Bernstein. And we saw the world premiere of A Quiet Place, which was Trouble in Tahiti, and that was the follow-up. So we went to that world premiere in Houston. And so I was introduced to a lot of, you know, classical music and opera. I mean, I was certainly the only person in Lake Charles, Louisiana, at 15 years old, who had Led Zeppelin tapes and Pavarotti tapes. I was the only person.
But you speak of maybe doing some other things with music. What did you play instruments, or what would those other things have been?
Well, I sang in rock bands for years, you know, when I was really young. I even when I was in at Louisiana State University, I had horn bands just to make money. Uh-huh. And I still love that kind of music. I love all different kinds of music.
And you made a recording of some rock. What was it called?
My band was called Mirage.
Mirage, that's
yeah,
right.
But that was my band in high school for 4 years. And we had a 30th year high school reunion a few years ago, and we got together and did some songs with the guys. And it was certainly a lot better than it used to be. One reason is everyone had money and the equipment was a lot better, and they'd been practicing for 30 years. I'd been practicing opera for 30 years.
So once you established that you did want to go in the direction of music, what did you do about it? Towards opera or singing.
I immersed myself in recordings and literature about opera. I listened to every single tenor recording that was out there throughout the ages. It got to a point where my friends and I, the other tenors and that I was going to school with, we would have contests. We would put on recordings and you know, hide it from everyone else and say, okay, tell me who this tenor is, you know. And I really got to a point where, you know, you could play a, you know, Martinelli or something from, you know, many, many years ago, and I could tell right away, you know, Georges Thiel or any of those things.
Who was your favorite back then?
My favorite back then was Jussi Björling. You know, and plus by the time his recordings came around, you could really tell the quality of the voice. It's hard to tell from the, you know, Caruso and, you know, the really early recordings, what they actually sounded like. But by the time Jussi Björling came around, the recordings were so much better. And he was my favorite, just for beauty of voice. He and Luciano also. I mean, Luciano had a beautiful voice. Of course, a lot of people have.
Instead of playing football.
Yeah, I did play football also.
You did too?
Oh, yes. In high school, yeah.
Other sports?
No, not really. I mean, I played when I was young, baseball and other things, but, you know. Not a lot. I do a lot of fishing. I still do a lot of fishing. I mean, I'm from Louisiana. Everyone has a boat.
So oh.
Sometimes we have to have a boat. But
do you fly fishing?
I have been fly fishing, but that's more of a stream kind of thing.
Stream,
in Louisiana we do inland fishing and deep water ocean fishing. So fly fishing is kind of tough if you're reeling in a 200-pound tuna, you know.
Do you find time to do it with your busy
yes.
schedule?
Oh, yeah. I always have.
So home is still?
I live outside of New Orleans now, yeah. I have children, so my wife and I were living in downtown New Orleans, but we had children, so we decided maybe we should move a little out because it can be a little dangerous.
You think still dangerous?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Where we were living, it's a fantastic party atmosphere,
right.
But with that party atmosphere, like everywhere else in the world, comes crime.
Oh.
So we didn't want to raise, you know, we have little children, and I want my children to be able to go outside at least, you know, when they're 15 years old by themselves. Here in New York, it's fine, but where we lived in New Orleans, it wasn't.
Were you there before Katrina?
Yeah, I bought my house there 5 months before Hurricane Katrina. I bought a house in the French Quarter. But I didn't have very much damage. It was fine. I had a little damage to one of the roofs, but that was it.
Very lucky.
But it was tough to take because a month later, the next hurricane, Hurricane Rita, hit my hometown.
Oh.
And it destroyed my mom and my brother's house.
Mm. Wow.
So it was tough. Those few months in 2005 were pretty tough. I was in Los Angeles watching on CNN like everyone else was.
So came time to go to college, and for you there was just one choice, LSU or not?
Well,
true?
It's got the... No, there. I mean, I could have gone a lot of different places, but LSU has the largest, one of the largest vocal departments in the South, and certainly music departments. So, you know, they had great teachers and a lot of facilities. Now it's even better. It's getting better and better. We have a new dean there, Todd Queen, Dr. Todd Queen, who was a tenor. So he's the dean of the music department. So he's really putting a lot of effort into making the opera department something special at LSU. And, you know, since I've been there, my teacher, Robert Grayson, has had quite a lot of success. Like, Lisette Oropesa was his student, and I went to school with her mother, by the way, which makes me feel really old. And Chad Shelton, and there have been many of his students that have had sung at the Met and had Met careers.
How did you get to Juilliard?
I auditioned by videotape. It's actually a kind of funny story. Because in the spring of my last year at LSU, I thought, well, I have to go somewhere else, you know. And at the time, I had a girlfriend that I'd met at Ohio Light Opera, which is in Worcester, Ohio. I'd been there two summers. And I was at Glimmerglass the summer before, which is 1988. And I just called Juilliard in the spring. And I said, yes, I'd like to audition, you know. And, you know, they said, okay, well, our auditions are over for next year. But... where do you live? And I've got this wonderful woman on the phone that I just talked to, and I said, well, I live in Lake Charles, Louisiana. And she said, well, if you'd like to fly to New York City, we can fit you in with a few of the voice teachers. But at the time, I didn't have money to fly to New York City. Mm-hmm. So I said, well, is there anything else? And she said, yes, we're auditioning for the undergraduate ballet in Houston, Texas in a couple of weeks. And she said, there'll be our head of admissions will be there. There won't be anyone from the opera department, but we have a videotape and we can take video of you. So I said, sure, I'll do that. Uh-huh. So I drove over with my dad from Lake Charles, Louisiana.
You wore your tights.
I did, yes.
What did you, how did you tell her? Is it, well, I'm a good singer or what?
Well, I told her, I said, look, I've sung, and already I'd sung leading roles at the Glimmerglass Opera, and I'd sung at Baton Rouge Opera, New Orleans Opera,
I see.
Mobile, and I'd already sung some roles here and there. And I guess I got lucky. I think she just was interested.
Right.
So I said, all right, fine. And she didn't mind. You know, I was going to make a videotape, and she thought, oh, I'll never hear that guy again. So I drove over, and I went in, and luckily for me, I didn't know it at the time, but the head of admissions was Carol Everett, who studied with Marlena Mollis, and she was a singer.
Mm.
So she said, I just saw her the other day. Last week, I did a recital at the Baryshnikov Arts Center, and she came, and we discussed this videotape. So she said, I'd been sitting there all day long watching these, you know, 17-year-old ballerinas, you know, and then here you come in, you know. And I sang five straight arias. She just kept saying, can you sing, you know, and I said, sure, I'll sing something else. So anyway, they made a videotape of it, and as I was leaving, she came over to me and said, you said, God, you're really wonderful. And she said, you'll be hearing from us. And I said, when? And she said, tomorrow morning.
Oh, is that?
And the next morning at my parents' house, I was staying with my parents, the phone rang, and it was the head of the Juilliard Opera Center. And he said, how would you like to come to Juilliard in September? And this was April.
Oh, wow.
So I said, sure, no problem. So that's how it started.
That's great. So off to New York. And what was that like?
Well, I assumed that there would be so many great tenors here that it would take me 4 or 5 years to really get a job and get my career started. But I got to Juilliard, and right away, the director set me up with Marlena Mollis as a voice teacher, who's still, I've only had two in my life, you know, Robert Grayson and then Marlena since then. And everything just took off really quickly. I went to my first audition a week after I was here for the St. Louis Opera, for their summer opera. And I walked in and I sang half of an aria, and the conductor, Stephen Lord, stopped me and he said, "How'd you like to sing Lenski at our company next summer in Eugene Onegin?" And I said, "Great, I'd love to." And he said, "Okay, we got the contract here." And Colin Graham was there also. And And I said, "Sure." And I signed it. And I said, "Would you like me to keep finish or sing something else?" And he said, no, that's fine." So I guess the word got out through Marlena and stuff. So things went really quickly. And then that spring, I did a lot of things at Juilliard and a lot of auditions. And I got an agent. Alec Treuhoff was my first agent. And that spring, I won the Met competition, or the Met auditions. And immediately I was asked to come into the Met Young Artist Program. So I was only at Juilliard for 1 year. It turns out that I was, you know, I got quite an education in opera from Louisiana State University and all the other things I did. I went to Italy for the fall of 1988, which is kind of funny because about a month ago at the Met, there was Marco Armiliato and Roberto Ronica. And we were all in Italy in 1988 together. Mm. Marco Armiliato, who's, you know, a brilliant conductor, he was my pianist.
Oh, is that right?
Yes. So we were all there together. So I had quite a bit of education before I got to New York. So by the time I started the Met Young Artist Program, I'd sung quite a few performances, you know, since the time I was 19 years old. So,
what was your debut at the Met then?
It was the Steersman in Flying Dutchman. And I found out 2 hours before on opening night that I was going on because I was covering. But I was in another opera at the time, a new opera that we were doing that year. So Jonathan Friend called me 2 hours before and said, "Okay, come to the Met. You're on. You know, the tenor that was doing your part canceled, and he went back to Chicago. I mean, he really canceled." So I said, "Oh, okay. No problem," and I was completely fine with it, you know. I didn't even see the dress rehearsal of this opera because I was rehearsing the other opera. I'd never seen a Wagner opera in my life. And the Wagner singers, I knew who they were, but I'd never heard them live. So I walked out on the set before, and I'm standing on this ship, and this giant mountain of a man walks over, and he shakes my hand, and he said, "You'll be fine, kid, you'll be fine." And he walked away. So it was Matti Salminen. And I knew who he was, but I'd never heard him live. So in The Flying Dutchman, Dalent, his part, the bass, sings two or three lines before I have my first line. My first line is, "Oh, Capitan." So I'm up on this netting about 15 feet off the stage, and he started singing. And my first thought was, "No one's ever going to hear me." And I went, "Wow, what a voice!" I was just stunned by the size and the sheer power of what, you know, his voice was incredible. But anyway, it went really well, and it felt like it went by in 2 seconds. And, you know, I had incredible coaching, and I was very prepared. Walter Tausig, I had many, many coachings on it, and I was very well prepared to walk out on stage that, even though I'd never been on the Met stage, so.
You seem to be capable of controlling your nerves very well, and that was always that way, right?
Yeah, I never got really nervous. I got anxious about things that I, you know, when you wake up in the morning of an opening night, you have all those hours to think about it, which is horrible. I'd rather, every once in a while in my career, I've had opening day where it's, you know, our first performance is a matinee, and I love that. You wake up, you eat, you have a couple hours and you go and do the show. I mean, the worst part of, you know, about it is waiting from the time you get up on opening night until 8 o'clock at night. But I was never really, really nervous because I enjoy performing. If I didn't have the voice to be an opera singer, I'd try to be a comedian or I'd do something else. I'd be in theater on Broadway or something else because I always enjoyed entertaining.
when you were in Juilliard, that you already have things going for you. But what makes you think that I need to go to the Met for?
Oh, that was my goal.
Oh,
yeah. Because I'd come a couple of times to performances there. I flew up and I saw Martina Arroyo, and because I knew her from Louisiana State University. And I came up to see her in Aida. She was in Aida in about 1985 or so with Giacomini. So I'd been there. And, you know, when you walk in and you're a young opera singer, I discuss this with Susan Graham all the time, you know. You know, the first time you go to the Met and you sit there and you think, okay, I'm going to try as hard as I can to be on that stage one day, you know. I didn't know it would just take me a couple of years, but I was going to try really hard to get there. And plus, I had really wonderful advice from somebody like Martina Arroyo, who had a long career there. And if someone like that says, you have the talent to sing at the Met, you have to believe them. So I just also, I was at Juilliard the first year of the Juilliard dorms. So I was, you know, all of us, you know, Franco Pomponi and Marie Plett and a bunch of us were the first people in those dorms. And every one of our rooms, for some strange reason, overlooked the Metropolitan Opera. So every morning when I'd get up, I would look out and there it was right in front of me. And I thought, wow, I got to get there. And it, you know, only took 8 months, but.
Amazing. How many performances have you sung? Do you keep track?
No. I haven't kept track, but I think Jim Courtney told me I've done 285 or 300 or something. He told me. But I've, you know, for a few years there, I did a lot of small roles when I was in the Young Artist Program, so.
What was the first time when you stand on that stage? What was the feeling?
Well, the first time I stood on the stage was for the Met auditions, you know, and just to walk out there. And I remember that Gail Robinson was there with us, and they did it differently then. Then we did the finals with just piano and a small invited audience. So they chose the 10 winners, or I think we had 8 the year that I won. And it was almost like an audition. You went out and you sang what you wanted to, and then they asked for one of the pieces. And then that was it. You just did one time. And then 2 weeks later, we had coachings for 2 weeks with wonderful, you know, we had... When I was there, we had Regine Crespin came for a week, and we had Renato Scotto for a week. You know, it was incredible. So we had coachings for 2 weeks, and then 2 weeks after we won, we did just a concert to where we walked out with, of course, we had pressure, but we were already winners. So I really believe in those days it was a little better setup, because for the concert, people had the confidence to think, you know, I've won, and this is my best. Instead of, I think now they're still competing at the concert, which might be great for the audience, but it's, you're not getting the best performances from the young singers that way. There's no way.
So when you finished the Young Artist Program, that's often a rough time for a young singer because you've been taken care of for 2 or 3 years and then you're suddenly on your own. Did that happen to you or were offers already coming in?
No, I already had offers. I had to sit down with James Levine, Jonathan Friend, before I left, and they said, we'd like you to go to Europe, and we will make sure that you sing Mozart roles here at the Met. We're going to cast you in Mozart roles here at the Met, but we think you should go to Europe and start, you know, auditioning and doing, you know, trying to have a career there also, and said, you know, there's just so many more opportunities for a Mozart tenor there than there are in the United States, and it's true. And luckily, here's another, I don't know, you know, everyone says I was born with a golden horseshoe, so I've had quite a few of these lucky breaks in my life. Sissy Strauss, who worked at the Met, was very good friends with Jan Hollander, who ran the Vienna State Opera. And she was speaking with him about a year before I finished the Young Artist Program at the Met and said, we have this great young tenor. And he said, oh, well, tell him to come sing for me. So through Sissy, I flew in between performances at the Met was the only time I could fly. So I was doing Brighella in Ariadne off Naxos, and James Levine was conducting. And Jan Hollander called my agent and said, we'd like to hire Paul for the 1995-1996 season, but he has to come and sing on stage in the next 2 weeks, or else we can't cast him for a year and a half from now.
Hold on to that thought right there. Unfortunately, we have to take a break, but we're going to come right back to arriving in Vienna.
Okay.
This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. We're here today speaking with Paul Groves.